Let's pray before we start the study. Father, thank you so much for the fact that you have regenerated us and filled us with your Spirit and baptized us into your body. I pray that you will teach us now, show us what is real and true. You know what each one of us needs to hear and understand. And I pray that you will glorify yourself among us this morning and make reality tangible to us. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Yesterday, I was standing in my kitchen with a group of women, and it was an interesting situation. We were putting booklets together for the conference, and Richard happened to be the only man in the group. He was managing the machine that did the spiral binding. So the rest of us were chatting, as women will do when they get together, and the fascinating thing about our little group was that our ages spanned, I think it's safe to say, 5 decades. And we represented women who have left Adventism over a period of the last 30 years. And in spite of the fact that we represented different generations and different times of growing up in Adventism, our experiences with Adventism were nonetheless almost identical. Even though the specifics of our lives were different, our experience with Adventism was the same. And the other thing that was so remarkable that actually was very moving to me, I realized that these women, which is just a representation of all of us here, have found in Jesus family that's different and far surpasses the bonds of gene pools. These women were my family, and I just don't know how to say thank you to God in a profound enough way because, well, you know what I'm talking about because we're all in this together. So I'm realizing that this whole subject of Sabbath makes sense in a new covenant way only when we understand what John just talked to us about, that we are really different people when we've been born again. And Jesus said that he said to the people when they said, your mother and your brothers are wanting to see you, and he said, who are my mother and my brothers? And I thought, you know, what a rude thing. How could the Son of God say that? But then he said something that as an Adventist I didn't understand, but I am beginning to. He said, my mother and my brothers and my sisters are those who do the will of my Father. And that's what makes us his family. So, before we look at specific questions and answers, we have to set the stage with the idea that we are now in a different covenant than the covenant when the Sabbath was given. So in your notes, you have a diagram, which I think we can get on the screen as well. I can't take credit for this diagram. I got this diagram from Elizabeth Inrig when she taught a class in the Old Testament several years ago. But in a nutshell, this demonstrates the major primary covenants that are discussed in Scripture. And here's the key. As an Adventist, and I don't know if any of you had a different understanding of this, but my bet is not much different. I did not understand the difference between an unconditional and a conditional covenant. In fact, I'm not sure I realized there was a difference or that there were different kinds. An unconditional covenant is a covenant that God makes by himself with no agreement from a human. Now, when we look at this diagram, we see the big starburst off at the left, and that represents creation and the beginning of God's promises to man. And if you'll think back, when was the very first covenant or promise that God made to man that promised something better than what they had come to experience? When was that first promise made? Genesis. Genesis 3, after they ate the fruit and God said, the woman's seed, think that through, is going to crush the serpent's head. So that was the first prototypical promise, and the rest of the Bible is spent explaining how God brings that promise to fruition. Well, we fast forward through Genesis, and if you think through the first 11 books are the story of the nations, how God filled the earth and judged the earth and filled it again. And in Genesis 12, something new happens. God calls Abraham. And we all know the story, but let me ask you a little detail. Why did God call Abraham? Does anybody know? What did you learn about Abraham? Did you ever hear that God kept Abraham from worshiping those pagan gods that his family worshiped? How many of you, I want to see hands, how many of you heard that God protected Abraham from worshiping those pagan gods? Well, that's what Ellen White said. What does Scripture say? It says nothing of the sort. It says Abraham, Terah, Lot, left Ur, and it says in Judges 24:4, got that backwards, 24:4, that they had worshiped other gods. Abraham was a pagan. He was chosen because God chose him, not because he was worthy. So in Genesis 12, God calls Abraham, and he makes promises to him. He makes a threefold promise, which he reiterates in Genesis 15 when he makes his actual covenant with Abraham. And the promise is for three primary things: seed, land, and blessing. But Abraham doesn't have any idea how this is eventually going to look. In Genesis 15, God makes a covenant with Abraham. He promises him his inheritance, his descendants would inherit the land. He promises that he will have descendants that will be greater in number than the stars of the heavens. And he promises him that he will be a blessing to the world, that God will bless him, and that a blessing will come through him. And then God asks Abraham to go and prepare sacrificial animals in the same way the Hittite kings of that era would make covenants with each other. Now, in the ancient Near East, if a conquering king made a covenant with a conquered king, they would have to set up terms of their agreement. And one of the things they did was to kill these animals and walk among them, making self-maledictory oaths like, I'm walking through here, I'm walking through these slain animals, and if I break the covenant, so be it to me. That was the meaning of those slain animals. But God did something amazing. He didn't let Abraham make that covenant with him. He put him to sleep. And God himself walked through those broken animals in the form of a smoking pot and a fiery furnace. And he himself made the covenant. That makes it unconditional. What does that mean? Abraham did not have to do anything to make sure that God would keep his promises. God will keep his promises with no help from Abraham, whether or not Abraham manages to be good, sinless, or not. So that was our first expanded picture of the promise God made to Adam and Eve. The unconditional Abrahamic covenant. Now, there are smaller covenants that occur. God reiterates his promises of the land in Deuteronomy. But then in 2 Samuel 7, and I'm going to come back to the Mosaic covenant, there is another unconditional covenant which we need to notice. I did not understand this. I mean, I understood the idea that God promised a king and a throne to David, but I did not understand the unconditional part. As an Adventist, this was another unconditional covenant that God made, where David said near the end of his life, not at the end, but he was aging, he said, I want to build a house for God. I am living in a cedar mansion, and God is living in a tent. And God said, no, you're not going to do it. You're a man of blood. Your son will build me a house, but I'm going to do something for you. You will not build me a house. I will build you a house. And he said, you will not lack a king on the throne of Israel. And he promised him a dynasty. He promised him progeny who would always sit on the throne, and it would be an eternal kingdom. This was an unconditional covenant, and we know that David was a man after God's own heart, but we also know David was a man who sinned. And this did not depend on David's accomplishing perfection. This did not depend on David's stopping sinning. It depended on God's promise. Now let's go back and look at Exodus. This was, for us as Adventists, I believe, the covenant that defined all the others. At least that's how I saw it. I remember being told many times, oh no, you know, the Bible talks about an old covenant and a new covenant and the Abrahamic covenant, and it, you know, it'll mention these covenants, but in reality, there's only one covenant. How many of you heard that? Yes, only one covenant. So we, from our perspective, took that Mosaic covenant that happened at Sinai and used that to interpret Abraham, David, the whole works. Well, what made the covenant at Sinai different from the covenant with Abraham? It was conditional. Moses came down that mountain with those tablets and said, this is what God wants. And the people said, we'll do it. Everything he said, we'll do. Well, that's a good promise. Well, we all know what happened. So God the core of that Mosaic covenant was God promised blessings for obedience, cursings, death for disobedience. And the covenant spelled out the fact that if Israel sinned, they would have to die. Well, did Israel have any chance of not sinning? There was really no chance. So, in a sense, you could say this was a covenant they couldn't even keep, right? I mean, this was really how it was set up. But why? Because God knew, and we've discovered this much more fully in Romans, that he was going to send his son as a propitiation for sin so that God would be both just and the justifier of those who believe in him. God himself was going to fulfill that covenant. God himself was going to pay the price of sin. He was going to die that death that the covenants mandated if there was disobedience. He was going to die in the person of his son. Okay, so before we leave this, I'll just summarize. I want you to notice in this diagram that the Abrahamic covenant has a line that extends past the cross into the future kingdom of God, where God fulfills all his promises. The land promises extend, the Davidic covenant extends, but the Mosaic covenant ends at the cross. Galatians 3 tells us that the law came 430 years after Abraham, and we can see in the picture that it came after Abraham, and it came until the seed would come, the seed that God promised to Abraham. So it had a beginning 430 years after Abraham, and an end, the seed. It was a conditional covenant that had a beginning and an end. The unconditional covenants are eternal. There's one other covenant that's eternal that God gave in the later part. Well, he gave it actually to Jeremiah and to Ezekiel about the time that Israel, that Judah was in exile to Babylon. That's about the time that both Jeremiah and Ezekiel wrote their prophecies. And God promised at that point when Israel was in, the northern kingdom had already been taken captive by Assyria and had essentially disappeared. We've never heard from those 10 tribes as specific tribes since then. They have been assimilated. And Judah, the southern kingdom, was now in exile. And they were saying, where's the promises of God? And God came to Jeremiah and to Ezekiel, and he said, I'm going to make a new covenant. And I'm going to make it completely different. I'm going to write my law on their hearts. I'm going to give them a new spirit, which is what John talked about earlier, and they will be my people, and I will be their God. But they did not fully understand what that was going to look like, but they knew that God had not forgotten them, and it was unconditional. He did not say, if they repent, I will make a new covenant. He said, no, I will do this. And he brought them back into the land, and we know that eventually, when Jesus came, he inaugurated this new covenant. Okay, let's go into the first question that we have. Now, these are questions that I've written down that I hear from Adventists. that I had myself as an Adventist. But as the years have gone by, some of the Sabbath arguments that Adventists use have morphed a little bit. So I'm going to try to address some of the ones that I hear most commonly now. How do we know the Mosaic Covenant was temporary? Well, we've already covered that to a great extent, but there are some really interesting texts that you really have to know are there. In Deuteronomy 5, now, what are the five books of Moses? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy is the book that where Moses renews the covenant with the second generation in the wilderness. Now remember, when they left Egypt, God made their covenant with them at Sinai, and then they rebelled. They rebelled against God. Moses struck the rock. They didn't trust God, and he said, "You're going to not going to the land. This generation has to die. There's going to be another generation that's going to come up before you can go into the land." So the first generation died. The second generation was growing up, and at the time it was just about time for them to go into the land of Canaan, Moses was an old man. Do you know how old he was when he led Israel out of Egypt? 80. He was 80. So he led them and he shepherded them in the desert for about 40 years, and then he died. So this is just before his death when he delivered Deuteronomy, and he was turning the management of the kingdom over to Joshua, his protege. And before Joshua took over and before Moses went up and died, he renewed the covenant, and he reminded them of everything that God had told them back in Exodus. He even reiterated the Ten Commandments, and you should read them. It's in Genesis 5. Little different. It doesn't talk about creation. It talks about being led out of Egypt. Not that the first one's null and void. It's just interesting. In Deuteronomy 5, 2-3, this is what Moses said to the second generation. "The Lord our God made a covenant with us in Horeb." Now, Horeb, you know, is another name for Sinai. People think it is the same mountain. And by the way, Horeb is the mountain where Elijah ran when he was running away from King Ahab and Queen Jezebel after that rainstorm came. And he, you know, killed the priest of Baal, and he ran to the mountain and he heard the still small voice. That was Mount Horeb. Isn't that interesting? We have Moses, the lawgiver, and then we have Elijah, the prophet, and they both end up at Mount Horeb. Anyway, "The Lord our God made a covenant with us in Horeb. Not with our fathers did the Lord make this covenant, but with us, who are all of us here alive today." Who are the fathers? In biblical terms, when Israel's talking, both testaments, who are the fathers? Yes! This is Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Joseph is often included. Those are the fathers, the patriarchs. Israel referred to them prior to the nation. The fathers were the ones that, the patriarchs, that God blessed, and to each of whom God gave the covenant before he actually formed the nation. So he says that God did not make this covenant he made it with us in Horeb, but he didn't make this covenant, this Sinai covenant, he didn't make it with the fathers. Now, how many of you heard that Abraham kept God's commandment? He kept God's commandments. The law was from the beginning of the world, and Abraham had the law, and Abraham kept the law. Well, Abraham didn't have the law. And Moses himself said that. "The Lord our God made a covenant with us, Israel, the nation, in Horeb. Not with our fathers did the Lord make this covenant, but with us, who are all of us here alive today." This is the nation he's talking about. So we know right there that the Sinai covenant is not eternal. Okay, Jeremiah 31, 31 to 33. This is the most beautiful, I think, exposition of the new covenant. "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel." And remember, they are in exile in Babylon, wondering if they'll ever see their homeland. Where is God? "And the house of Judah, not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on that day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of Egypt. My covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, declares the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them. It's really kind of overwhelming, isn't it, when we lived so long under that other one? And I will write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Now, there's another place where God expressed the new covenant as well, and that was to Ezekiel. Ezekiel and Jeremiah actually overlapped in their prophesying, in their lives. They were in different places, but they were writing to Judah. And this is what God said to Ezekiel. And I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh. Isn't that an interesting way to put it? I will remove that heart of stone. And you know, they always told us, stone is eternal, the law of God. Well, I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. This is exactly what John was describing earlier when he talked about, and you know, we've experienced it. We are born again through no effort of our own. But when we realize who Jesus is and say, I repent, please forgive my sin, he is faithful, he forgives us, and he seals us with his spirit, and he puts a new desire in us. We really have a new heart. There's no looking back. We still have bodies that sin and that have fleshly desires, but the real us, the soul that John was describing, it's new. And we have new desires. Okay, now we go to the New Testament. Those are our Old Testament. I mean, there's more. But those are examples of Old Testament texts that explain that the Old Covenant was not eternal. Hebrews 8, the writer of Hebrews. You know, I hated Hebrews as an Adventist. Did any of you, like, understand it? I thought it was the most confusing book, and now I look back on it and realize what a travesty it was that Hebrews was used to support the Adventist sanctuary doctrine. That is not what Hebrews says. The author of Hebrews quotes Jeremiah in Hebrews 8. But as it is, Christ has obtained a ministry that is as much more excellent than the old as the covenant he mediates is better. Do you get that? Christ is better than the ministry of the old covenant, and the covenant itself is better since it is enacted on better promises. Well, what are those better promises? What were the promises of the old covenant? All you have said we will do. I will kill you if you disobey. All you have said we will do. The promises couldn't succeed. They were human. So the better promises of the new covenant are what promises? Yes, it's Jesus saying, I have come to do your will, a body you have given me. I have come to do your will. It's Jesus' promises. And Jesus is who? He is God the Son. He is the eternal, almighty God, unlike what our prophetess said. Jesus is not Almighty God. And her husband said that. He is Almighty God. And he said, I have come to do your will. For if that first covenant had been faultless, there would have been no occasion to look for a second. Well, that's very clear, isn't it? There had to be a new one. It's not the same as the old. And now, 2 Corinthians 3, 4-11. I love this passage. And I want us to read it together. It's something we should never forget. There's two slides, so just read through it with me. Such is the confidence that we have through Christ toward God. Not that we are sufficient in ourselves to claim anything as coming from us, but our sufficiency is from God, who has made us sufficient to be ministers of a new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. Now, if the ministry of death, carved in letters on stone, came with such glory that the Israelites could not gaze at Moses' face because of its glory, which was being brought to an end, will not the ministry of the Spirit have even more glory? For if there was glory in the ministry of condemnation, the ministry of righteousness must far exceed it in glory. Indeed, in this case, what once had glory has come to have no glory at all because of the glory that surpasses it. For if what was being brought to an end came with glory, much more will what is permanent have glory. Look at that part about Moses. Now, in Exodus, it said Moses would put the veil over his head when he would come out of the tent of meeting because his face was glowing. And it actually said, and I didn't realize this until recently, that he would talk to Israel while his face was glowing and then put the veil over his head. Now, Ellen taught us, and I was taught in Adventist school, that Moses put the veil over his face because it was so bright that the people would be blinded by it and he didn't want to, you know, hurt their eyes. But look what Paul says. Actually, and remember, Exodus says he spoke to them with his face shining. Thank you, Johnny. He spoke to them with his face shining, but then would cover it. This tells us the rest of the story. He would cover his face so they wouldn't see the glory fade. He knew it was fading. It would come back when he went back into the tent of meeting. Why do you think that was? It probably gave him authority, definitely. Why would God do that? For authority, for them to know that this was God's word to them through his prophet. But the fact is, it was fading glory, and Paul is telling us that the ministry of the Spirit is unfading. So when we are indwelt by the Holy Spirit, he doesn't come and go. What happens is, you know, we move in and out of letting him have access to all of our thoughts and hearts and feelings. He gets more of us. We don't get more of him. He gives us all of himself, and it is an ever-increasing glory that he has brought us into. Do you realize what a miracle this is? We are living people walking in a world filled with people who are still dead. It's amazing. Okay, next question. How do we know the law is not eternal? Because that is the primary argument of Adventism. The law existed pre-creation. Do you remember learning that? Lucifer broke God's law. And that was the beginning of the whole great controversy. He had pride. He wanted to be like God. He said, God's law is too hard. People can't keep it. It's unfair. And Lucifer broke God's law, which was eternal. Well, that's not what Scripture says. The law was something God wrote for Israel. God himself is, as John was saying earlier, he is righteousness, he is holiness, he is perfection, he is morality, he is everything good and more than we can imagine. He does not answer to a law. He is the law. He is the law. Let's look at Exodus 35:28. And this is one of the places where Adventist hermeneutics really breaks down, and we really have to be clear on this, because you can argue this point, these points with people who still have an Adventist perspective, as most of us know, endlessly without any resolution, because they have a view of the law that separates it from the person of God. You know, they say the law is eternal, the law is a transcript of God's character, but it's not. Jesus is the transcript of God's character. The law was simply a set of instructions for the governance of Israel that laid down the consequences for sin and the results of belief. And it worked out a whole living metaphor that would explain in the life of Israel what Jesus was going to do as the God-man. Exodus 34:28. The words of the covenant are the Ten Commandments. You cannot separate them. The Ten Commandments did not predate Moses. They did not predate Abraham. They were not up there with Lucifer. The Ten Commandments were given to Israel. Galatians 3, 17 to 19. The first one was a little glimpse from Moses himself. This one is a look back from the perspective of the new covenant. Paul, the one to whom God gave the job of explaining the new covenant, as it says in Ephesians 3, that he gave him the grace of explaining the administration of this mystery. This is what I mean. The law, which came 430 years afterward, after Abraham, does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God so as to make the promise void. Now let's just walk through that really quickly. What is the previous covenant? The law, which is Sinai, does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God. What's the covenant we learned about that was previously ratified by God? Abraham, the promise of seed, land, and blessing, unconditional covenant. The law does not annul the unconditional covenant so as to make the promise void. For if the inheritance comes by the law, it no longer comes by a promise, but God gave it to Abraham by a promise. Why then the law? It was added because of transgressions, until the offspring should come to whom the promise had been made. And it was put in place through angels by an intermediary. So Paul is telling us the law was added. It was added because of transgressions. It was added to show Israel, to show humanity, that they could not please God. They had to have intervention apart from their own efforts. They could not please God, and they were worthy of death. Okay, now, this argument, Sabbath began at creation. You've all heard that one, right? Let's look at Genesis 2, 1 and 3. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God finished his work that he had done. And as Dale often says when he talks about this, Dale Ratzlaff, the word, the Hebrew underlying that finished, is simply the word that means ceased. God ceased. He was done. He finished his work he had done. The next one is the ceased. He rested. He ceased on the seventh day from all his work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and made it holy because on it, God ceased from all his work that he had done in creation. Well, if you think back to what John said about God as a spirit and does not have a body, the concept we have of rest, particularly as Adventists, is what? It's physical. It's like not working. It's like napping. Well, even Ellen said napping wasn't allowed, but, you know, it was that idea. But this is God the Spirit, God who is Spirit, ceasing from his work. Now, this is not like, whew, okay, I'm done. He's just done. And there is a difference in the formulation of the seventh day. How did Genesis put it for the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth days? And the and the morning were the first, second, third, fourth, fifth days. Seventh day does not have an evening and a morning. There's no beginning, no ending, and there's no hint that God's ceasing ended. He was done. He didn't get up on Monday and go back to work. Not only that, Adam and Eve were created on the which day? The sixth day. And it was their first day. And that seventh day was their first day or second. It wasn't their seventh. They were created into God's finished work. They were at rest. They were created into rest. The command to keep Sabbath was not given in Genesis. It says God ceased. It does not say he asked Adam and Eve to rest. And he did not give them a seventh-day command. Okay, next argument. I think this one has been popularized by Doug Batchelor. God said to remember the Sabbath. Now, how can you remember something he hadn't already said? Well, I find that a bit disingenuous, but let's look first at Exodus 28 to 11. Did you all memorize this in Sabbath school? I did. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant, your female servant, your livestock, the sojourner who's within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Now, there's some things we have to look at. One of the basic hermeneutical principles that I have learned from Elizabeth Enrich over my years in women's ministry with her is this simple little thing she always says: context is everything and words matter. Now, as an Adventist, at least this is how I remember Sabbath school classes. We prided ourselves at looking at scripture and kind of reading into it what we think it might mean. Remember the Sabbath day. Well, okay, then that must mean it had existed before. If remember, you know, I mean, it's the parsing of the words. But if you just look at the words, you have to ask yourself, wait a minute, what does that actually mean? Remember, if I say to you, you're leaving, and you're just about to go out the door, and there's a stack of mail on the table, and if I say, oh, remember to take that mail to the post office, does that mean I had told you it previously? Does that mean maybe I hadn't even told you? Maybe it was yours, and I could see like my Tracy, our adopted daughter Tracy, says to me, remember to, you know, get what you're going to get at Costco. It's like, you're right, I had almost forgotten. I had told her I was going to get it. But remember doesn't mean that it's been a previous command. It's just like, remember your jacket. So it doesn't have to mean it was said before. However, in Exodus 16, we did have a previous Sabbath command, but this is the first one in all of Scripture. Exodus 16 is where God gave the manna, and it's so interesting. This manna experience came about a month before Sinai. They had been wandering in the desert. They'd been grumbling. They'd wanted the quail. They were griping that they didn't have food. God sent them the quail. They got sick on it. And then he said, I'm going to give them the manna. And he told Moses that the manna was going to fall 6 days of the week. And on the sixth day, they had to collect double. And if they didn't, there would be none on the seventh day. Any other day of the week, if they collected extra, it would rot overnight. But on Friday night, it would not rot. There'd be enough for Sabbath. And he said, the Sabbath is a Sabbath to you. It's a Sabbath to the Lord. And you are to have the manna for six, Sabbath rest on the seventh, and I will provide your food. Now, what is the manna in a kind of a, if you think in terms of literature and typology, what does the manna represent in Scripture? In a big picture, it represents sustenance. Where else do we see bread used in symbolism in Egypt that represents God's provision? I'm sorry?
Passover.
We see it in the table of showbread, a loaf for each tribe. The bread, the symbol of the manna, is representing the bread of life. Who is the bread of life? Jesus. Now, it's interesting to notice that in John 5, when Jesus fed the 5,000, this is a fairly new realization for me. I'd been memorizing John 5, and I realized that Israel expected that when the Messiah would come, that he would do something that would be reminiscent of Moses. Because Moses had told them in Deuteronomy that God is going to send a prophet like me. Well, what did they remember him for? They remembered him for water in the desert, manna, the law. They remembered him for all the things that defined them as a nation, caretaking them in the wilderness. So they had in their mind that the Messiah was going to come and do something that was going to remind them of Moses. And when Jesus fed the 5,000, they thought, ooh, manna, food for 5,000. And they tried to crown him king. But Jesus disappeared because he said, it's not time. But he talked to them about this. And he said, you know, Moses didn't give you the bread of life. The real bread of life comes from the Father in heaven. And the fact is that the manna was set up as a representation of the Lord Jesus himself. He said to them in John, I am the bread of life. He's saying, you've been looking for someone who'll feed you. Look at me. I personally am going to feed you. And he goes on to say, you have to eat my flesh and drink my blood. Yes, I'm the one that was like Moses, but it's not like you thought. The manna was a representation of the Lord Jesus. And God gave Israel the symbol of the bread of life and the symbol of Sabbath rest at the same time. Rest in Christ and food, true life, were given at the same time. So when the law was given and the fourth commandment said, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy, well, they already had the Sabbath from about a month out in the desert, along with the manna. And interestingly, they had manna through their whole 40 years of desert wandering. Isn't that amazing? By the second generation, they probably almost forgot how it had begun. Now, let's look at 1 Corinthians 11, 23 to 25. The Israelites were asked to remember the Sabbath, the symbol, the time when God finished his work and ushered them into his perfect, completed work, rest in his work. In 1 Corinthians 11, Paul is talking about the Lord's Supper. And he says this, for I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. God gave the church a new remember. Sabbath was the remember for Israel, which pointed forward to the Lord Jesus, and now we remember his death and burial and resurrection. Well, then, Jesus kept the Sabbath. Well, let's look at Galatians 4, 4, and 5. There's a reason Jesus kept the Sabbath. Jesus was born under the law. Paul is explicit about this. Jesus was born under the law. He lived as a Jew. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law so that we might receive adoption as sons. Well, he was a Jew. He had to keep the Sabbath. But let's see what he did with that through his life. We go back to John 5. John says Jesus broke the Sabbath. Now, I've always heard this explained. Well, no. No, he didn't really break the Sabbath. He just broke all the Pharisaical rules attached to the Sabbath. But John himself said Jesus broke the Sabbath. Let's look at this. This is he'd healed the man at the pool of Bethesda who had been lame for 38 years, hadn't been able to walk, and he did it on the Sabbath. And as I've heard Dale say, this man had been lying on that pallet for a good 38 years, and this was a heavy load. And what did Jesus ask him to do? Pick it up and carry it and walk. He not only healed him, he asked the man to break the rules against carrying a load. And lest you think that there were no rules about carrying a load, that those were Pharisaical rules, it does have in Nehemiah, I believe it's Nehemiah. It's not in the Pentateuch, but I believe it's Nehemiah, where there is a law. It is a rule. It talks about not carrying a load and being stoned if you're breaking the Sabbath by carrying a load. So it was something they all knew, and Jesus broke the Sabbath. And John explicitly says he broke the Sabbath. Not only that, but think about it. What ceremonial ritual law did Jesus not break? He touched lepers and made them well, and he did not have to go into a ritual cleansing. He touched dead people like Jairus' daughter and the widow of Nain's son and brought them to life, and he did not have to go through a ritual cleansing. Israel had to. He broke all the ceremonial laws because it was a way of saying to Israel, I am the one you're looking for. I am the one that the prophet said would give sight to the blind, make the lame walk, make the dead live. I am the Messiah. I have life. John 7:21-24. Jesus taught that there were always shadows that trumped Sabbath. Now, this is an amazing thing to me. This is another thing that's fairly new for me to realize. This is after he healed the man at the pool of Bethesda, and the Jews are starting to say to him, you have a demon. And he says to them, I did one work, and you all marvel at it. Now, the one work he's referring to in context is the healing of this man on the Sabbath. For this reason, now the context is my healing this man on the Sabbath, and you're saying I have a demon. For this reason, Moses gave you circumcision, not because it is from Moses, but from the fathers. And on the Sabbath, you circumcise a man. If a man receives circumcision on the Sabbath so that the law of Moses will not be broken, are you angry with me because on the Sabbath I made an entire man well? Don't judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment. Now, here's the deal. Circumcision predated Sinai, right? Circumcision came with Abraham. Circumcision was the way a Jew entered the covenant. A Gentile was not even allowed to keep the law unless he was first circumcised. He had no access to the law. Paul tells us that in Ephesians, that the Gentiles were without God and without the covenants of promise until Jesus. So circumcision is the mark of being brought into the covenant. But even in the Old Testament, and very explicitly in the New, we learn that circumcision of the body was a shadow for what? Circumcision of the heart. The new covenant miracle of God putting a new heart in us. So in the Old Testament, the symbol of becoming part of the covenant body took supersedence over, it took precedence over the law. On the Sabbath, if it was the eighth day after a boy's birth, on the Sabbath, that boy would be circumcised so as to be brought into the covenant people. The sign of belonging to God took precedence over the law, even in Israel. And Jesus is reminding him of that. There's always been things that were more important than the law. Belonging to me is more important. And here's circumcision, the sign of belonging to Israel and the circumcision of the heart that is us being ushered into the new covenant. Jesus is the reality of the wholeness and the rest that Sabbath foreshadowed. He himself is how we are, when we receive him, we are circumcised in the heart. And it's interesting, just by the by, don't know what to make of it, just interesting, that in the old covenant, it was the men who received the sign, and in the new, men and women are equally circumcised of the heart. Circumcision made scars to mark a person as God's, but Jesus, in his life of healing and in his ushering in the new covenant, Jesus removes scars and makes an entire person well. Forgiveness of sin and healing the body were inseparable for him. When he was accused of Sabbath breaking in John 5:17, following his healing of this man, Jesus said, I and my Father are always working. My Father is always working and I am working too. Ephesians 2:11-13, it's not the text, but it's the reference to the text. Acts 15, the Council of Jerusalem, and the book of Galatians, they eliminate circumcision because that was the entrance rite into the law. If you had no circumcision, you had no access to the law. Gentiles were strangers. That's the text. Covenants and strangers to the covenants of promise. Okay, then we hear, we'll keep the Sabbath in heaven, and they always quote Isaiah 66:22-23. For as the new heavens and the new earth that I make shall remain before me, says the Lord, so shall your offering and your name remain. From new moon to new moon, from Sabbath to Sabbath, all flesh shall come to worship before me. Well, notice here, one very important thing. The Sabbath in this text is connected to the new moon. And by the way, Israel had a lunar calendar. The lunar calendar is how a month was determined. It's not like a solar calendar that we have today. So with the new moon would come a new month. And with the new month would come a new reckoning of the 7 days. So from month to month, the seventh day was a different day of the week, if you get what I mean. I mean, you could have on a new moon, which was a holy day, a Sabbath, you could keep the new moon, and it might just happen to be that the new moon would come 1 day after the seventh day of the previous month. So you might even have two Sabbaths close together or two in the same week. Every month, the new moon would determine the weeks. So the Sabbath was connected to the new moon. It's interesting to me that in the world we live in, God has like made sure we have a Gentile world. We don't live with lunar calendars. We don't even, I mean, it's like hard even to talk about it, to explain it. A few people have things that they do on lunar calendars, but in general, the world functions on a solar calendar. We live in a Gentile world. We don't even know how to figure the Sabbath the way Israel figured the Sabbath. So we cannot separate Sabbath from the new moon. We also know from Revelation 21 and Revelation 22 that in the New Jerusalem, in the heaven and earth made new, there's not going to be any night in the New Jerusalem because there's not going to be any day or night because the Lamb is the light, and there won't be any moon or stars or sun because the Lamb is the light. So without a passing of time, how can you have a seventh-day Sabbath? What we will have there is an eternal, unbroken Sabbath in the presence of the Lamb. Jesus himself will be our Sabbath. Time is created. Sabbath is a creation. Created things are not eternal, and God is not subject to them. And the idea that I have heard so often in the past and still from Adventists that God will keep the Sabbath, we will keep the Sabbath with him, is silly. God made that law he gave to Israel. He is not subject to it. It is a created thing. Time is created. All right. Those who are saved keep the commandments of God. Well, what does that mean? John 15, 12. Jesus gave us a new commandment. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. That is the new commandment. John 6, 29. This is the work of God. They said to him, tell us, this is after he fed the 5,000, and they're like, who are you? What is this? And he goes, tell us, what should we do to work the works of God? And Jesus says, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent. That is it, the work of God. In all John's writings, this is very important, the word commandments comes from the Greek word entole, and Dale expands on this in his book, Sabbath in Christ. He's a very excellent study on this. But the word, the Greek word entole, is a word that means sayings or teachings. And when John uses the word commandments, and this is true in all five of John's books, the epistles, the gospel, and Revelation, the underlying word is entole, and he is referring to the teachings of Jesus, not the Ten Commandments. When John refers to the law, he uses the word nomos or Torah if he's referring to the whole book of the whole Pentateuch. And then finally, we have this God never changes argument. He gave the law, he never changes. Well, no, he doesn't change. He is sovereign over all things. His purposes never change, but God's methods do change. And let's look at some examples from Scripture. I love this text. I remember when we were just figuring out the new covenant, our son Roy, our older son Roy, was about 12, and he came down the hall one evening and goes, look at Hebrews 7:12. Well, here it is. And this is what it says. Now, if perfection had been attainable through the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need would there have been for another priest to arise after the order of Melchizedek rather than the one named after the order of Aaron? For when there is a change of the priesthood from Aaron to Melchizedek, there is necessarily a change in the law. New law, law of Christ. So don't tell me God never changes. God doesn't change, but that's a straw man argument because God's methods change. Hebrews 4, 4 to 7. I love this one. For somewhere, and it's so funny that this author who obviously knew the law, somewhere it was spoken of the seventh day, and God rested on the seventh day from all his works. But again in this passage he said, they, Israel, shall not enter my rest. Since therefore it remains for some to enter it, and those who formerly received the good news, meaning Israel, failed to enter. Why? Because of disobedience, unbelief. Again, he appoints to a certain day, today, saying through David so long afterwards in the words already quoted, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Well, this author is very clearly saying God changed another thing. To Israel, he gave the command of a seventh day, but he has given us a new day. And we now have today. In the new covenant, we have today. God has told us there will be a new heaven and a new earth, so don't say there's no change there. God gave the law after destroying the world with a flood and after calling Abraham. There were definitely changes of administration. God's ways are not always the same. His purposes are. Righteousness is not right doing. And this is one of the little pet peeve arguments. Righteousness is right doing. No. And this is, I think, the culminating argument for why if righteousness is right doing, then we have to say keeping the law is the manifestation of righteousness. But Jesus was very clear and Paul was very clear that that's not true. In Matthew 5, do not think I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I haven't come to abolish them, but to fulfill. That does not mean to say, okay, here's the example. If a person leaves a will, leaving his estate to his only son, that estate is not in the possession of that only son until the man dies. When he dies, the will is fulfilled and the heir takes the inheritance. So that's what Jesus is doing with the law. He's fulfilling it. It's pointing towards him. It's saying he's going to come. It's testifying of him. And when he comes, he fills all those shadows full of meaning, and he himself inaugurates the new administration. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. But their righteousness, Paul even talked about his own righteousness. He was flawless, he says in Philippians. As to the law, I was flawless. But that is not righteousness. Romans 3. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes not life, but the knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God has been manifested, get this, apart from the law. I mean, like, law's here, here's Jesus, apart from the law. Although, and here's what the law did, the law and the prophets bear witness to it. The law, not just the prophets, the law bore witness to the coming righteousness. The righteousness of God. That doesn't mean he says, okay, now I'm going to help you be good. The righteousness of God is God himself. He puts himself in us. It is his, Jesus's personal righteousness that God credits to our account. Finally, last text, Philippians 3, 8 to 11. Indeed, I count, this is near the end of Paul's life, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I've suffered the loss of all things, and you know, I know a lot of you here have suffered the loss of a lot. And of all things, and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him. Not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible, I may attain the resurrection from the dead. So in conclusion, the Sabbath was the sign of Israel's commitment to keep the terms of the Mosaic Covenant. The Sabbath foreshadowed the true rest of Christ in his finished work. He is that perfect rest, that perfect righteousness to those who believe. And this is what Jesus says to each of us. Come unto me,
all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest.